Welcome to the second of our lectures on science and cooking associated with the class that we're teaching, the science and cooking from haute cuisine to soft matter science. I'm Dave Waits. I'm the professor doing the class, and we're very privileged to have many wonderful chefs visiting and helping us, and we're trying to share this experience with everybody in the community. So I'm going to, as I said last time, you're going to have to suffer through some science, since this is a science and cooking lecture series, suffer through some science by me or somebody, one of the people teaching the class, each time before we get to the chefs. So let's begin. First of all, it's very important that I acknowledge all the people who've sponsored and helped us. Jose Andres from Think Food Group, Alicia Foundation have been instrumental in both the support and the intellectual contributions. Montferrand, Whole Foods on River Street. We're very fortunate, particularly tonight, we're going to actually use one of these wonderful thermal baths from Fusion Chef by Julabo. These are great things that we have in my laboratory, but now we can use them for cooking as well. We'll learn a lot about it tonight. And some support from one of the Catalan banks. Okay, so tonight I also would like to give a very, very special thanks to Tony Maas from Craigieon, Maine, who helped us enormously this past week and opened up his kitchen and his restaurant to some of our visitors as part of the beginning of the class. And so special thanks goes to Tony. And tonight, after you hear the science, we're going to learn about precision cooking, doing things like really precisely controlling the temperature, and our science discussion in class this week really came around to discussing the important concepts that one needs to understand to learn something about the different ways of controlling the temperature and the different ways of controlling the nature of food. And so that's what I want to spend a few minutes trying to describe. The theme of the week was phase transitions, and so I'm going to tell you just a little bit of conceptual ideas of the phase transitions that we discussed and show you some of the demonstrations that we did in class to learn about the phase transitions. So, well, I think you're all familiar with a common material, one that's important in both what we eat and how we prepare food, and that's water. And water has three well-known phases. If you cool water down below 0 degrees C, it turns into a solid, it becomes ice. As you warm it up, it becomes a liquid. You can drink it between 0 degrees C and 100 degrees C, it's a liquid. And if you heat it above that, it's a gas. And so there are three phases of water. And there are transition temperatures, in this case, 0 degrees C and 100 degrees C, at which the water undergoes a phase transition. And we can understand the nature of the phase transition by looking at the molecular scale. Water is made up of water molecules. When it's a solid, they form an ordered structure. They can form a variety of different crystalline structures. That's the ice. As it warms, the order is lost, and the molecules can move around more easily. They can pass more easily over one another, but they're still in the condensed phase, and that's a liquid. And if they're warmed even more, then they're no longer a condensed phase, but rather they evaporate and they fill the whole room. That's a vapor or a gas. So those are the three phases of water. Now, there are other kinds of effects that can control the phase transition. When I was much younger, I used to do a lot of mountaineering. And I learned something when I did mountaineering. Even though you're at very high elevations, you still try to cook and eat well, not as well as you can eat here, but you eat as well as you can. And what I learned, particularly if I was, say, around fairly high base camp at 16,000 feet, if you try and cook pasta, just normally you end up with mush. And the reason is that at high elevation, the pressure is decreased. It's significantly decreased at 16,000 feet. It's about 60 or 56% of what it is at sea level. So it's significantly decreased, and the boiling temperature of water in which you're cooking the pasta is decreased. So here we have a plot where we've plotted now not only the phase transition temperatures of water at one atmosphere, that's at sea level, but also if you go up to 0.7 atmospheres, at higher elevation, you see the transition, the boiling temperature decreases. If you increase the pressure, the boiling temperature increases. And so you can put these together now onto a two-dimensional plot, pressure and temperature, and these are these three different lines that we showed you, and you could put these together, and draw a line through them. And this is now a phase diagram, a two-dimensional phase diagram, which describes the state of water as a function of both pressure and temperature. Here's the solid, the liquid, and the gas. And you can see that as the pressure changes, the temperature of the phase transition also changes. If you look at other fluids, ethanol is an excellent one. We had a wonderful talk about drinks, and it's a very important component of drinks. It has a somewhat different, the behavior is still the same. It's a liquid and a gas. The solid would be way down, but the temperature at which it boils is somewhat different. And that just depends on the nature of the interactions between the molecules. So in water, there are a lot of hydrogen bonds that hold the molecules together. In ethanol, there are still hydrogen bonding, but there's also a different component of van der Waals interactions. So there are a variety of different interactions. Each of these interactions have different kinds of energies, and that determines something about the nature of the phase diagram, of the nature of the behavior. And in fact, we discussed in a sort of qualitative fashion the way you can understand the energy as a function of the separation. So I'm imagining some generic separation between the molecules, and I'm plotting here the energy between them. And if the molecules tend to attract one another, as all materials that form a liquid or a solid, a condensed phase, must do, they tend to attract one another, and they can lower the energy of the two molecules by coming close together, by undergoing this attractive interaction. So if they're far away, there's no energy of interaction. As you bring the molecules together, they're attracting one another. The system is lowering its energy, and the amount that it's lowered this energy is the energy of the bond that's holding together you. If you try and push them together even farther, they just can't occupy the same space. And to try to push them together, you would have to raise the energy of the two molecules. So this is a way of describing it, and this is the energy of the bond. And the energy of the bond at the phase transition, you essentially have to do something. You have to put energy into the system to break that bond in order to have the molecules come apart. And of course, we use that just in a qualitative way. We introduced our equation of the week. So this equation is just a way of relating it. Basically, it's saying the temperature at which the phase transition occurs, you have to put enough energy. This is converting the temperature into energy. You have to put enough energy to break the bond, to put enough energy to pull the molecules apart, to overcome this attractive energy, these attractive forces that are pulling the molecules together. Well, there's other interesting kinds of phase diagrams, and so liquid nitrogen is something we had a lot of fun working with, and I want to show you some unique feature of liquid nitrogen. Unfortunately, Daniel Rosenberg, our demonstration guru, is going to help by doing a demonstration. What we're going to do is, you all know what liquid nitrogen is. It's a liquid. It's very cold. You can see it. It's almost minus 200 degrees C at room pressure. It's a liquid, and it sits right here because it's evaporating, so it has to cool everything down. The fact that it's foaming like this is basically you're seeing the liquid nitrogen slowly cool the glass, and as it cools the glass, you see a lot of vapor. It's changing into a gas, but if it remains liquid, it has to stay below this temperature. So it sits right at this point. But now what we're going to do, we need to zoom in on this. And so I think we'll watch this, and I'll describe what we're going what happens. What Daniel is going to do is lower the pressure. So he's putting a jar over top. It's a little dangerous, so he's putting our protection in front. Heloise, maybe you want to move back. No, I think you're okay. And he's going to start evacuating it. And if you watch carefully, hopefully we'll be able to see the vapor disappear. But remember, this is a liquid that's in equilibrium with the gas, and we're lowering the pressure. I can see it if I look at it. Can you zoom in just a bit with the camera? Oh. You see what's happened? It's turned into a solid. This is nitrogen, solid nitrogen. And all Daniel's done is lowered the pressure. So it's ice made of nitrogen. And if you watch it, as he raises the pressure, it turns into a liquid and then starts to evaporate again. Thank you, Daniel. So let's try to understand that, just thinking of our simple phase diagram. Here's a blow-up of the phase diagram. And basically, what happened, let me see if I can use my pen. What happened is we started at room pressure, we were here. And so we were in coexistence between a liquid and a gas. As we lower the pressure, it has to come down this line. It has to come down this coexistence line. The temperature is being lowered because we're evaporating some of the liquid into the gas. It lowers the pressure, it lowers the temperature, and it has to sit, whatever pressure it is, has to sit at that point. But notice the phase diagram is interesting, that the solid line crosses right here. And if you lower the pressure enough, you go directly between a solid and a gas. And that's what we saw happen. So we can just very simply understand the behavior of what we're seeing just by looking at these phase diagrams. And so that's the very cool thing, actually solidifying nitrogen just by lowering its pressure. Okay, so we can now think about doing other things with controlling the pressure and controlling the temperature, things that are more directly related to food. Of course, we use water, it's both a food and it's a way of controlling the temperature. So if we want to solidify something, for example, where's an egg? This is a fresh egg. I'm going to hold it very gently because I have clumsy fingers. I'm not going to break it open, but if I break open a fresh egg, what phase is it? Solid, she says. It's a fresh egg. It's not a trick question. I can't do any tricks. It's a liquid, right? I won't break it open, but if you don't believe me, one of these excellent chefs will break. We'll see some. Oh, Daniel prepared me an egg. This is an egg, right? It's liquid. So, of course, if I want to solidify it, Daniel will help me. How do I do it? I lower the temperature, right? That's what it says. I should lower the temperature. So we'll lower the temperature. We'll put the egg in the liquid nitrogen. We're using nitrogen now as a mechanism, as a medium to control the temperature. So this will take a minute or two. We have to get it nice and solid. So this is the way we cook eggs, right? Isn't this always the way we cook eggs? Don't you go home at night and cook eggs like this? Well, that's a good question. She's asking, does it actually cook? So what does cook mean? She says it denatures the protein. No, it freezes. It solidifies. But I'm just showing you now that there's many more types of phase transitions than just the simple phase transition for water. So you think it's solid yet?
It's still boiling.
You know, it takes a while to cook an egg. How long do you cook an egg for? When you, oh, she doesn't cook. Who cooks eggs?
6 minutes.
6 minutes. Okay, I think we have one that's been cooked for 6 minutes. Do we have a hard? This one. This was cooked. This was put in boiling water for 6 minutes. 10 minutes? Where's Naveen? No, I'll let you break it. If I break it, I'll make a mess. Okay. So this is a solid egg. This is a solid egg. You can spin solid eggs, right?
Yeah.
Do you have a fresh egg? You can't spin a fresh egg, right? Daniel can... Sorry, I should have told you, Daniel can do anything.
No, that's still fresh.
Okay. That's still...
Oh, it's partially done.
Just, it's a soft egg, right? You know, soft yolk. Okay. Thanks, we have the screen back. So now you understand perfectly well why I do this course in collaboration with chefs. I clearly don't cook. I'm just the physicist here. So you can lower the temperature. Of course, the way you normally do it is you put it into hot water and you raise the temperature, right? Now, what you're doing is using water as a medium to transfer heat. And so we can understand this in a very simple way because we can do a whole bunch of other things by transferring heat. I'll show you some of the things you're familiar with, other things you're not as familiar with, but Joan Roca will tell us a little bit about some of these things. So, one thing you're familiar with is the pressure cooker. The pressure cooker is what we absolutely had to use when I used to go mountaineering. You can increase the temperature at which the water, for example, boils by increasing the pressure. And a typical pressure cooker, you can go to about 2 atmospheres. So that's one way of taking advantage of the phase diagram in the medium you're controlling the heat. Another way is with a rotary evaporator, or a rotovap. This is now becoming more common among chefs, and I hope Joan will tell us something that he does with it. And you can again understand the properties, the basic properties, just from this phase diagram. What you do is you have both a controlled a temperature bath and you evacuate the liquid that's in the rotovap, and when you evaporate it, it changes the boiling temperature so you can evaporate different things off. In actual fact, it's much more complex because you have various aromas that you can get to evaporate more quickly, so you can, in fact, enhance the aroma in what you collect and cool down and distill out here. So that's another tool that we'll hear about. And then finally, we have these beautiful immersion heaters and their ways of now absolutely controlling the temperature with exquisite precision. And the important thing that we'll learn is that the water typically is just something that transfers the heat. The food itself, as it cooks and as it undergoes different phases, will undergo different phases at different temperatures. It doesn't have to be the temperature to which it's heated or to which the surrounding medium is heated. And the beauty of an instrument like this is that you can precisely adjust the temperature of the surrounding medium to exactly the temperature at which you want to bring the food. So with that, this was a sort of a summary of the kind of science that we did. And I'd like to introduce Harold McGee to introduce Joan as our chef.
Thank you, and good evening. It's a huge pleasure for me to be able to introduce John Rocha to you. For all kinds of reasons, one of them being that I had one of the most memorable meals of my life at his restaurant in 2005, when he was just beginning to work with the rotary evaporator, and he made a dish that just made my jaw drop. And I hope he'll talk about that one. If he doesn't, I'll talk about it later. Anyway, he comes from Girona, which is a city about an hour northeast of Barcelona. His parents had a small traditional Catalan restaurant there. He and his two brothers opened a restaurant next door to their parents' place in 1986, I think. And these days, it has 3 Michelin stars. It was voted this year by his peers in the business, the second best restaurant in the whole wide world. And it's in part because of he and his brother's dedication to progress in the craft of cooking. And what that's meant is that he and his brothers have pioneered in a couple of technologies that have just transformed modern cooking. In 2001, he published a book about this, about precise low-temperature cooking, which had been done for maybe 10 or 15 years in France, but kind of sporadically and not very visibly. In 2001, he published a book on the subject, which just changed the life of every chef who came across it, and everyone came across it. It meant that for the first time, you could really control the doneness of meat and fish precisely, and eggs as well. It was just revolutionary. It sounds simple. You know, cooking is heating things. Control the heat. But until he pointed out that you could do it this way, and he gave precise recipes, directions, tips, the whole thing, he basically gave the world a manual by which they could cook their meat, fish, and eggs much better than they ever had before. So that was the first thing he did. Then, 3 or 4 years later, he pioneered in the use of the rotary evaporator, which Dave showed a slide of, which essentially extracts aromas from ingredients and from things that maybe you wouldn't have considered as ingredients before. That meant that you could do magic with aromas, with flavors that you just couldn't do before. And that has transformed the business. So Joan is the perfect person to be leading off this series from the leading chefs of the world on the science of cooking. And so, without further ado, Joan Rocha.
Thank you. Bona tarda.
Good evening.
Disculpeu que no parli bé l'anglès, i per tant és molt millor que tenim una traducció, un traductor fantàstic que irà traduint i explicant tot el que farem avui.
And excuse me that I don't speak in English, so we'll have an interpreter doing that for me.
Després del que ha dit el Harold McGeer, jo crec que el millor que podria fer és callar i marxar i quedar-me. Però tot i així intentarem.
After the introduction by Harold McGee, the best thing that I can do is to run and leave the place and shut up.
Thank you, thank you.
Thank you, thank you very much.
Bé, abans de res, i abans de començar a parlar de temperatures i de cuina, voldria presentar-vos a casa meva, tot i que ho ha fet molt bé el Harold. Intentarem passar un petit vídeo on expliquem un dia al restaurant.
And before starting the lecture, I would like to talk about my place, home, my restaurant in Spain, even if Harold has touched on parts of it. So we're going to show you a little video to get you in the mood.
El restaurant que veieu és el fruit de molts anys de treball. Aquest any fa 25 anys que vam inaugurar el restaurant.
that the restaurant that you're seeing is the fruit of many years of work. It's 25 years since we opened it.
Som tres germans, com ha dit Harold. Josep s'ocupa dels vins, Jordi dels postres, jo de la cuina salada.
As Harold has mentioned, we are three brothers. Josep is sommelier and deals with wines, and Jordi is the pastry chef, and I do the rest.
I l'espai que tenim ens permet desenvolupar la nostra feina tal com a nosaltres ens agrada. Una sala molt lluminosa, una cuina gran, ben equipada, i el restaurant dels pares molt a prop, on hi anem cada dia a dinar tots. Fem 200 metres de camí per anar a casa, a Can Roca, a casa dels pares de tota la vida.
And the space that we have is very appropriate for our needs. We have a very luminous and bright dining room, we have an ample kitchen, and then the best thing is that we have my parents' restaurant 200 meters away from our place, so every day for lunch, all of us go there.
I ens permet tocar de peus a terra i tenir els orígens molt presents.
And that keeps us grounded and very much in touch with our roots, our origins.
Utilitzem totes les tècniques que tenim a l'abast, tradicionals, modernes, brases de llenya d'alzina.
We use all sorts of techniques, traditional, modern, embers done with oak cork trees.
Ens agrada molt jugar amb els aromes i amb la complicitat entre aroma i sabor.
We like to play a lot with aromas and the complicity between aroma and flavor.
I ens interessa molt tenir molt presents la cuina catalana, la cuina de la memòria, la cuina tradicional, a partir de la qual moltes vegades fonamentem el procés creatiu.
And we keep very much in mind our, traditional Catalan cuisine of our family, and that helps us sparkle our creative process.
Okay, ens centrarem doncs amb la tècnica de cocció al buit. És una tècnica que nosaltres hem treballat força.
We're going to talk about sous vide cooking, and that's a technique that we work a lot on.
És una tècnica polivalent, l'utilitzem molt i per diferents motius.
It's a multi-purpose technique that we use for many purposes.
El control de temperatura és essencial, per nosaltres és important, perquè és el que ens dona al final la precisió i ens dona el resultat ideal que busquem amb cada aplicació.
Controlling the temperature is essential to that process because it gives us the final, we reach the final temperature for the product.
L'equipament que utilitzem, l'hem anat veient, les màquines d'envasar al buit, a l'esquerra.
The equipment that we use, as you can see, are on the left. That's the thermal vat.
Els termostats d'immersió.
Immersion thermostat, yeah, like a thermal vat.
Bosses de buit.
Sous-vide bags.
Rotaval, que després l'explicarem més detingudament, i els forns de buit continu, que també els comencem a utilitzar.
And the rotator distiller that we are going to elaborate later on.
Entenem que hi ha dos tipus de buit. Un és el bàsic, que és el que més utilitzem, i l'altre és el buit continu, que el fem servir l'utilitzem amb el rotor a vapor.
Okay, there are two types of sous vide. The first one is basic and the one is continuous that we use with the rotator.
Per nosaltres, les grans avantatges del buit són són vàries, no? Aquesta és una d'elles, que és l'absència d'oxidació durant el procés de cocció. Al no tenir aire, doncs aconseguim que els productes que tenen fàcil oxidació la puguem d'aquesta manera evitar.
The advantages of the sous vide cooking are many, but the first one is to avoid oxidation. Since there is no air, there is no oxidation.
Ens permet tenir un control molt precís de la temperatura a cor de producte mitjançant unes sondes que ens permeten establir el mètode. Ens permeten establir la relació producte, temps, temperatura per cadascun d'ells.
And it allows us to have an extremely accurate temperature, and we have some tables where you have the time and the final product.
Per nosaltres és molt important la regularitat en el restaurant, i amb aquest mètode ens permet poder tenir molta regularitat i ser molt homogeni amb els acabats.
Consistency in a restaurant is very important for us, so this method allows us to achieve that time and time again.
La tècnica ens permet tenir un gran respecte per al producte, pels seus nutrients i per les seves propietats gustatives o no, organolèptiques.
Another big advantage of this technique is that it allows us to respect the nutrients as they are and the flavor.
Seguit. També ens permet estalviar o evitar la pèrdua de pes i, per tant, de propietats i d'aigua durant el procés de la cocció.
This method as well avoids the product losing its weight and shrinking.
L'efecte de la pressió durant l'envasat ens permet també enganxar productes, en aquest cas són dos filets de llenguado, després ho veurem un exemple molt més pràctic, però diguem-ne que també ens va bé aprofitar aquest efecte de pressió que es produeix quan tanquem la bossa al buit i ajuntem, en aquest cas, dos productes.
Another advantage is that, for instance, we'll see that during the demonstration, to seal or to bind two fillets of sole together. And they stay that way after, you know, when we have the final product.
Alhora és una tècnica que ens permet també coccions prèvies, després les explicarem, però el poder coure abans un producte amb cocció llarga, imaginem-nos una espatlla de xai.
Then it's a method as well that allows us continuous and long cooking. Let's imagine, for instance, lamb shoulder.
Si nosaltres coem aquesta espatlla de xai per un sistema tradicional, el posarem en un forn amb una temperatura moderada, però ho tindrem 2-3 hores, amb la qual es perdrà molt de productes, s'evaporarà, es deshidratarà, es ressecarà i la textura quedarà molt més estellosa, molt menys melosa.
Then, for instance, let's imagine that we cook the shoulder of lamb in a traditional method and we put it in the oven for 2 hours and a half, 3 hours. What's going to happen is that part of it is going to evaporate and then it's going to become drier and the product is going to get dehydrated and it's going to lose its moistness.
I ens l'haurem de menjar de seguida després d'haver estat rostit. No el podrem conservar. Sí, ho podem fer, però el resultat no serà agradable. Serà rescalfat.
And we'll have to eat it immediately after being roasted, because if we reheat it, it's going to have a different, you know, taste.
En canvi, si l'envasem al buit i el tenim durant 24 hores a 63 graus centígrads...
Well, if we cook it using the sous vide method and we cook it for 24 hours at 63 Celsius.
Aconseguirem una cocció molt homogènia, molt melosa, mantindrem la textura del producte, serà molt tendre i no serà ressec ni estellós.
We'll achieve a very homogeneous texture and the product is going to be very moist and not dry at all.
I el gran avantatge és que un cop passat aquest procés de cocció podrem refredar de cop i provocar una pasteurització I una millor conservació del producte cuit.
Another advantage is that after immediately after sous vide cooking we can cool the product and we're going to achieve a pasteurization and which is very important as well for the final result.
Per tant, ens permetrà tenir una preparació d'un producte cuinat en perfectes condicions higienico-sanitàries amb un període més llarg que si ho féssim per als sistemes tradicionals.
And then we'll be able to keep the product under very hygienic conditions and with the best health advantages as well that if we're doing that in a traditional method.
I prolonguem doncs el temps de conservació d'un producte acabat.
And we're going to achieve a longer shelf life.
També això agilitza molt el servei perquè fa que els processos d'acabats es puguin fer d'una manera molt més pràctica, molt més àgil I molt més adaptada a cada restaurant I a cada mètode. No? Cada cuiner acaba utilitzant aquesta tècnica de la manera que millor li convé, aprofitant totes aquestes avantatges o algunes d'elles.
No? Yeah, taking advantage of all these techniques and advantages of sous vide cooking, what we have to do is we can agilize the serving process as well, the moment in serving the food.
Per això nosaltres separem les coccions al buit amb dos noms, en direm directes o espontànies, no? Durant el servei, I coccions indirectes. Ara veurem les que anomenem directes. Anem a veure un exemple.
We have two types of sous vide cooking. The first one we're going to call it direct or even better immediate cooking, and then the other one is going to be the long cooking sous vide.
Vale, seguim. Ara veurem un exemple d'un llenguado que nosaltres en diguem llenguado mediterrani. És un plat que pretén expressar els colors I la llum del Mediterrani, en certa manera, a través d'una interpretació de productes que nosaltres associem amb el Mediterrani.
One of the first example is going to be sole Mediterranean style, and what we want to do in what we want to achieve in this dish, it's a flavor and light that reminds us of home and the Mediterranean.
Això és fonoll salvatge.
That's
que liquem.
That's wild fennel that we cook.
Liquarem fonoll, també liquarem taronges, liquarem bergamotes.
We're going to liquefy the fennel. We're going to liquefy oranges and bergamot.
Pinyons,
pine nuts,
I olives verdes,
and green olives.
I amb tots aquests sucs farem el mateix que fem ara.
And with all these sauces,
lligar-los, donar-los textura, amagar agar.
And all these sauces and these flavors, we're going to bind them with using agar.
Un cop hem texturitzat aquests sucs, els emulsionem amb oli d'oliva.
Once they have some texture, we emulsify them with olive oil.
L'oli d'oliva és un fil conductor de tots aquests sucs que ens permet tenir salses amb matisos, amb sabors que nosaltres relacionem amb el Mediterrà, en què l'oli d'oliva fa de fil conductor.
And the olive oil plays the role of the spine, bringing all the elements together.
Okay. El llenguado el posem en una dissolució de sal, 10% de sal per aigua. Aigua I 10% de sal durant 4 minuts.
We bath the sole in a mixture of water and salt. It's 10% of salt and we keep it there for 4 minutes.
És una molt bona manera de salar, molt homogènia.
It's a very good way to salt something. It's a very homogeneous way to salt something.
I molt precís I molt regular alhora.
Precise and regular.
Els dos lloms del llenguado els posem junts a dins la bossa, enganxats per la part en què estaven unides les espines, el lloc on hi havia les espines.
And the two fillets of sole, we put them together where the spine were before.
I el posem a coure a 55 graus durant 4 minuts.
And we cook it at 55 degrees Celsius for 4 minutes.
Mentre es cou el llenguado fem un caramel d'oli d'oliva, això és caramel, deixem caure una gota d'oli d'oliva I com que està calent el caramel, la força de la gravetat de l'oli d'oliva fa que baixi I es tanqui una petita càpsula de caramel d'oli d'oliva.
And what we do in the meantime, we make an olive oil caramel. What we do is we do some caramel and we drop an olive oil, a drop of olive oil, and then it becomes candy caramel olive oil.
Tenim el llenguado molt melós, molt ben cuit, molt al punt, però ens falta la reacció de mallar, ens falta el daurat i el fem a la brasa perquè agafi un perfum lleuger de brasa i un color agradable.
We have the sole now, which is very well cooked, but we need something else to finish the dish. We need to achieve as well the Maillard reaction. We need a little bit of browning.
So només, we, només 30 segons per cada cantó.
So what we do in the embers, we mark it, we just score it for 30 seconds each
perquè
side.
No, perquè no es ressequi, perquè no es deshidrati.
So it doesn't become
només
dry.
Només perfum i color.
Dehydrated. So the only thing that we seek is the color and the smoke.
Hem col·locat les cinc salses per ordre. És un plat que el servim així, en perpendicular. El llenguado està en perpendicular, les salses estan seqüenciades.
What we do is we play the sauces in order. It's a perpendicular dish and we put one sauce next to the other.
Amb l'oliva verda coincideix el caramel d'oliva amb el pinyó al pinyó, amb la taronja la pell de taronja, amb la bergamota la flor de bergamota i amb el fonoll la flor de fonoll.
Then we have the olive oil with the olive oil candy, the bergamot with the bergamot, the orange juice with the orange juice, with the orange, and the pine nut with the pine nut essence.
Lo important del plat és que la textura del llenguado és molt amable, molt agradable i tenim al mateix temps el sabor tradicional de la brasa de llenya d'alzina.
The thing is that we want to achieve at the end is that the texture of the sole, it's very nice, lovely texture, but at the same time it has like a little traditional note on the flavor that we get from the embers.
Si haguéssim cuit el llenguado a la brasa des del principi en cru, ja estaria bo, però no estaria tan melós en l'interior, hagués quedat més ressec, més deshidratat.
If we had cooked the sole to start with on the grill, it would have been much drier, dehydrated, and it wouldn't have achieved the moistness that we seek always.
És un altre exemple, això són rogers, que els hi traiem també les espines.
Another example, here we have red mullets and we debone them.
També és una cocció directa, una cocció al moment, és una cocció que no es pot conservar, estem en temperatures molt baixes, per tant, són temperatures de servei, són 55 graus Celsius, per tant, és una temperatura molt, molt ajustada, que és de servei, d'arribar a la comanda a la cuina i posar-lo a coure al moment.
And it's another example of immediate sous-vide cooking because what we do is it's at the moment, it's very fast. It's 55 Celsius again for 4 minutes. And what we do is we get them started when we receive the order, the ticket.
Hem posat en l'interior dels dos lloms una mica de paté de fetge de roger.
And between the two fillets, we've used a little bit of its own liver, red mullet liver.
Tanquem, aprofitem la pressió de la bossa, el tancar, i el posem a coure.
And, you know, and we give him a bath.
Passats 5 minuts, traurem la bossa, traurem el roger de l'interior i muntem el plat.
After 5 minutes, we get out and we open the bag and we plated it.
En aquest cas no farem una cocció complementària, irà directament al plat. Volem la textura del roger molt, molt melosa, quasi com si hagués estat cuita dins d'un suquet.
And in this case we don't need secondary cooking. What we want to achieve is the texture, if it had been done on a fish too.
El suc que hi ha al voltant és un suc fet amb les espines i els caps del roger, torrats, i per tant amb un brou molt reduït, molt concentrat, molt saborós, molt potent.
Del sauce that it's next to it, it's surrounding it, it's a chief roasting the heads of the red mullet and the spines until they're very concentrated, it has like a very strong, very powerful, very noble taste.
una mica d'oli de cirereta, unes gotetes, oli d'oliva amb, amb cirereta, guindilla, chili.
Chili, okay. Mm-hmm. And then we, then a little bit of olive oil and a little bit of a chili.
Okay. I aquest és un altre, és un altre exemple.
I aquest és, and sí. This is another example. Vale. Sous vide cooking.
Vale. Pararem ara un moment i veurem com hem posat a coure, mentrestant estàvem parlant, hem posat a coure un filet amb whisky Lagavulin, un whisky Island, un whisky que té unes notes fumades, lleugerament fumades.
D'Islàndia? D'on és el whisky?
Whisky d'Escòcia.
D'Escòcia.
Mm. Lleugerament fumat.
Okay, so you know, we're going to stop for a second, and while we were talking, we put on the thermal bath a filet with some whisky from Scotland.
És això mateix que estàvem fent aquí, però en aquest cas amb una carn de cocció ràpida, diguéssim, una carn tendra, no té teixit conjuntiu, és un filet, podria ser, de fet és una avellana, perdó, és la part de la, del llom, no és el filet exactament, eh? Però en tot cas és una carn molt tendra que permet una cocció al moment.
And instead of using fish here, we use some meat, we're going to use a filet, and it's a very tender type of meat that that needs a very precise
20 minutes a 50 graus.
Immediate cooking, 20 minutes at 50 degrees.
I ara l'únic que farem serà donar-li una mica de color a l'exterior, just per donar una capa cruixent i daurada.
And now what we're going to do is we're going to brown it a little bit on this side, just to give an, you know, a nice color.
Per tant, de la mateixa manera que el llenguado només el passàvem per la brasa, un momentet, ara estem fent el mateix amb la carn.
So exactly the same thing as we did with the sole fillets, that we put it on the grill just for a second. We're doing exactly the same thing now on the pan with the meat.
No pretenem coure-lo a la paella, sinó perquè ja l'hem cuit precisament a la bossa de buit a la temperatura que volíem nosaltres.
It's not to cook it because it has already been cooked in the thermal bath.
El buit ens ha permès que dins la bossa el whisky impregnés el seu gust a la carn. Per tant, el buit ens ha servit també d'una molt bona manera de condimentar el producte.
And another advantage of sous vide cooking is that it infuses, the whisky has infused the meat with an incredible taste.
Per tant, el tenim daurat de fora i de dins molt, molt melós, molt, molt gustós.
And the outside is brown and nice in color, and inside is extremely moist and very tasty.
No sé si es veu a la càmera, sí.
Can we see it on the camera?
La capa que hi ha entre l'exterior i la part rosada és molt prima.
The outside crust is very thin.
Si l'haguéssim cuit tota l'estona aquí, la capa entre l'exterior i la part rosada seria més gran. La part blanca seria més gruixuda.
And if we had cooked the whole time on the pan, the outside crust, the layer would have been much thicker between the outside and the pink part of the meat.
Okay. Sí, hi ha un element de... El plat l'hem muntat una miqueta amb el que hem trobat. El més important és la cocció. Fixeu-vos amb la gran quantitat de carn rosada que hi ha en la peça. I els elements que hi ha són verdures que hem saltejat. Les hem cuit al buit, a 85 graus. Les verdures els hi hem de trencar la cel·lulosa, per tant la temperatura sempre és molt superior, són 85 graus.
Then we've played it with, you know, a few things that we found today, and some vegetables. And what we've done is we cooked them as well sous vide for 10 minutes at 85 Però to break the celluloid inside of.
Una particularitat del buit també és poder aprofitar la impregnació. En aquest cas hem agafat unes boletes de meló i les hem posat dins una bossa de buit amb cru, amb suc de remolatxa.
And another thing is that infusing part is very important as well, because what we've done is we got some melon balls, we put them in the bag with beet juice.
Així hi ha un element, que és aquesta peça. Ens agrada molt jugar i sorprendre. Hi ha un element que no saps ben bé què és, té gust de meló, però té gust de remolatge, té gust de terra, perquè li ha donat aquest gust l'aigua de remolatge que hem posat a dins la bossa. És un meló cru amb gust de remolatge. És una de les característiques que ens permet el buit de la impregnació. I creem com una mena d'element nou. És una nova... un nou vegetal que té textura de meló i gust de remolatge.
One thing that we like to do a lot is to play and surprise. So what we've done is to infuse the melon balls with beet juice, and no one is expecting that. So when you eat, you wonder what's that,
seguim.
You know, you have to guess a little bit.
Okay, seguim amb exemples de cocció llarga, no? Cocció...
And now we're going to go and give you some examples of a long sous vide cooking.
Això és una oca.
It's a goose.
Que el que farem és una terrina calenta. Volem tenir una mena de paté i, per tant, utilitzarem la tècnica de buit per poder baixar molt la temperatura de cocció i tenir molt present en el resultat final la textura i la barreja de magres, grasses i gelatines i condimentació que hi ha en el plat.
And then what we're going to do is we are going to cook it for a long time because we want to lower the temperature, and what we do is to, you know, we mix that with other ingredients to achieve, you know.
És pa, clara d'ou, llet, el fetge de la oca.
Here is the bread. We have the liver as well, egg whites.
Sal.
Salt.
Bolets, ciurenys picats.
Mushrooms, grounded mushrooms.
Tòfona negra.
El black truffle.
Foie gras.
Foie gras.
Papada. Papada de porc, greix de porc.
El porc fat.
Ho barregem tot bé.
And we mix everything well.
Amb la carn de la oca.
With the grounded meat of the goose.
Okay. I el que pretenem és que aquesta barreja, com dèiem, no es fonguin les grasses, o es fonguin poc i estiguin presents, i facin una barreja molt homogènia, molt melosa, molt gustosa, i poc eixuta, és a dir, molt tendra i molt melosa.
What we try to achieve here is moisture, but at the same time what we try to achieve is that the fat do not melt completely and they retain in the final product, and the final terrine, it's very moist and hydrated.
Això és el foie gras sencer, un tall de foie gras, una tira llarga de foie gras, foie gras cru.
That's a long piece of raw foie gras.
Fetge d'oca cru.
It's a goose foie gras.
Yeah. I donem aquesta forma cilíndrica, intentant que quedi just al mig la peça de foie gras.
We have a cylinder shape and keeping the foie gras in the very middle of it.
Okay. Tanquem el buit i el coem durant 30 hores a 63 graus.
Okay, we seal it and we cook it sous vide for 30 hours at 60 degrees Celsius.
Okay. Passat aquest temps, refredem, és a dir, pasteuritzem, com explicàvem abans amb l'espatlla de xai, no?
After that, what we do is we cool it and to achieve a pasteurization, as we explained before with the lamb shoulder.
Fixeu-vos que no ha deixat anar gairebé aigua, no ha deixat anar suc, sinó que tot està encara aquí, no hi ha hagut deshidratació, i per tant el greix, fixeu-vos que el foie gras encara està sencer en l'interior, després de 30 hores de cocció està sencer, no s'ha fos.
And please notice that the fat and even the size of the foie gras have not melted, so everything keeps the previous shape.
Durant el servei, en el restaurant, quan ens demanen una reacció d'oca a la Royal, agafem un tall, el tallem, el posem a dins la bossa i el regenerem, l'escalfem a la mateixa temperatura de cocció.
What we do is when we receive the order in the restaurant, we put the serving piece inside of a bag and we cook it exactly at the same temperature that we cooked it previously.
En aquest cas, l'acabàvem amb una compota d'albercoc.
And in this case, we finish it with some jelly, apricot jelly.
Compota d'albercoc, flors de borratja i brots de remolatxa.
Flowers and beet sprouts.
I la salsa, que és el suc de l'oca, és a dir, el fondo d'oca reduït, molt intens de sabor.
And the sauce it's made with
els ossos que no hem utilitzat en el
with goose broth that we reduce, you know.
Sí? Okay. Un altre exemple és el coll de xai.
Another example is with the neck of the lamb.
Ja l'hem cuit 24 hores, 63 graus.
We have cooked it for 24 hours at 63 degrees.
És una part del xai que s'utilitza molt poc, però és molt interessant perquè té una part molt ben proporcionada de greix, magre i gelatina.
And it's a very interesting part and that is not used at all, and unfortunately because it has like a very good proportion between meat, fat and gelatin.
I el que fem és coure'l, com he dit, llavors el desossem, l'os de la columna vertebral surt molt fàcilment.
With the bonnet and it's very easy to take it away from the spine.
Entre l'os hi hem posat lletons.
And in the middle we've used sweetbreads.
Tornem a tancar.
We seal it, we close it.
Recomposem el coll sense l'os i amb els lletons.
Like reconstituting the neck without the bones and with the sweetbreads.
El film ens permet donar la forma i després tornem a coure només 20 minuts perquè es recomposi i quedin enganxats els lletons dins del... És a dir, es fongui la gelatina i torni a quedar un altre cop tot pres, tot enganxat.
And the plastic wrap gives it the shape, its shape, and we cook it only for 20 minutes, for a small, you know, amount of time, so that everything, all the flavors, and bind together.
El procés de regeneració és molt semblant al de l'oca, és a dir, també tallem la reacció, la posem amb la bossa i a la mateixa temperatura de cocció escalfem i acabem.
The serving process is very much the same as when we did the goose before. We put it in a bag with a little bit of sauce and then we cook it.
En aquest cas, el plat l'acabem amb préssec, amb una terrina de... Això és una compota de préssec amb mantega.
Okay, and we finish the dish with a marmalade made with peach and butter.
Una espuma de formatge de llet d'ovella i puré de patates, un puré de patates amb formatge de llet d'ovella.
A foam made with sheep's milk cheese.
Una espuma calenta de patata i formatge d'ovella.
And it's a hot foam made with potato puree and the cheese, sheep's milk.
Com que tots els elements són molt melosos, molt tendres, el que fem és posar un tros de pell de la panxeta del xai que l'hem secat, l'hem cuit a la planxa de crom perquè quedi molt cruixent, que és aquesta peça que hi ha.
And for crispiness, what we do is we get a piece of skin from the lamb, from the abdomen of the lamb, and we put it in the dish as well for an element of crispiness.
Okay. Un altre de les avantatges que pots posar allà, del buit és aprofitar la pressió que tenim quan retractilem, quan utilitzem les bosses que són retràctils en el buit.
Another advantage of sous vide cooking is to use the bags that shrink.
Això és un calamar que el tallem a tires i l'amanim amb pebre vermell de la vera, pimentón de la vera.
And here we have calamari. It's cut in stripes, in long stripes, and we dress it with pimenton de la Vera.
Recomposem, volem fer un cilindre, per tant, tornem a col·locar totes les peces sobre un plàstic film.
To reconstitute it, we put all the pieces together and we wrap it with some plastic.
I el tancarem amb una bossa de buit, que és una bossa retràctil, que per tant, quan la submergim amb aigua bullint, es quedarà, pressionarà tot aquest cilindre i farà que les s'enganxin entre elles les tires de calamar.
And what we do is we use a special bag, which is a shrinking bag, and the moment that we submerge it in the water, in the hot water, it's going to shrink and give the shape to the strip of calamari.
Reposar,
cool it.
I li donem un cop de fred important, un cop de congelador perquè quedi pres i ho puguem tallar molt fi.
And then we freeze it for a while so then we can cut it the way that we want, very thin.
Ara estem creant un recipient nou, és a dir, això és un bol de plàstic de vidre, un bol de vidre que hi hem posat pebre vermell de la Vera a dins.
And what we're doing now is we're creating a new type of container, a new bowl. It's a glass bowl, and we have pimenton de la Vera inside.
Amb una bruixeta molt calenta, soldem l'exterior i, per tant, ens desprenem del plàstic sobrant.
And what we do is with a very, very small brand, we weld it.
Fem un forat amb un extrem.
We make a little hole in one of the extremes of the bowl.
Volem jugar en aquest plat amb la complicitat entre aroma i gust. Per tant, és per això que hem fet tot aquest joc amb el recipient.
And it's a complicity between flavor and taste, so that's why we've done the bowl, you know.
Aquest és el rosetó que hem fet, hem tallat aquell cilindre de calamars, l'hem tallat i ens queda així, a sobre d'un puré de patates.
So that's what we've done with the calamari, in that special, very special shape, and we put it on top of some potato puree.
El col·loquem a sobre d'aquest plàstic.
It's on top of the plastic.
Que el plàstic és flexible.
Flexible.
I ens ajudarà a fer sortir el fum molt a poc a poc.
And it's going to help us, you know, to release the smoke little by little.
Això són petits popets que els assaltegem a la planxa.
Baby octopus, griddle.
Sorry, eh? Els posem a sobre del puré de patates amb els rosetons de calamar.
We place it on top of the potato puree, on top of the calamari. Calamari glass, almost.
I utilitzem una pipa que habitualment s'utilitza per altres, per cremar altres coses, però que nosaltres la fem servir per cremar serradures de llenya d'alzina.
What we do is we use a pipe that usually has other uses. But in this case, we use it to smoke cork oak.
La idea és que el fum es barreja amb el pimenton, amb el pebre de la Vera que hi ha sota, i surt un aroma. Cada vegada que anem a agafar una miqueta de puré de patates, surt una miqueta de fum. Cada vegada surt una miqueta de fum i juga amb l'efecte olfacte-gust.
What happens is that the smoke gets mixed with the pimenton de la Vera, and every time that we reach for a little bit of potato puree, a little bit of that smoke gets released. So we play with smells as well.
Okay, ara veurem els exemples de destil·lació que són dos exemples diferents. El primer que passarem, les ostres al xablís, està basat el plat en si amb una idea que és molt present a la nostra cuina, que és el de partir del procés creatiu del món del vi.
Then now we are going to talk about two examples of distillation, and the first one that we're going to talk about is oysters with Chablis wine, and you know, we'll bring into the forefront one element that it's very very essential for our cooking, which is wine.
Abans potser hauríem d'explicar que la idea d'utilitzar el rotavapor, el rotaval, ens va venir de l'observació de veure que a la cuina, quan nosaltres estem fent un brou aromàtic, se'ns en va per la campana tot l'aroma, no?
The idea to use a rotator evaporator is that it came to us when we cook broth, when everybody cooks broth, that you can see that all the good parts of the broth go out in smoke.
Tot se n'anava i vam pensar de quina manera podíem captar aquests aromes que estàvem provocant contínuament a la cuina, com els podíem captar, recuperar i utilitzar-los. És a dir, la idea era captar l'ànima dels productes i tenir d'aquesta manera dos versions o dos elements: allò que s'evaporava convertit en un recuperat en líquid i la concentració per l'altre cantó.
And so what we thought is that what would be the way to keep these good smells for us instead of letting them go, and that you know, not only to keep them but to bring them to the forefront of the dish and be the soul of the dish.
Vam començar a destilar sucs de tòfona, sucs de bolets, sucs de caps de gamba, i era molt interessant veure que el que recuperàvem després de la destil·lació era una altra dimensió d'aquell mateix producte.
We distill truffles, we distill mushrooms, and we distill shrimp heads, and then it was a very, very interesting process for us, a process of discovery.
Fins que un dia vam destil·lar, vam atrevir-nos a destil·lar terra.
Until one day that we dare to distill soil.
Vam descobrir un nou element a la cuina, és a dir, vam tenir un ingredient nou a la cuina, que és un destil·lat de terra, i per tant, el gust de la terra, que era molt curiós, quan te'l posaves a la boca i tenir a la boca un sabor que tu tenies relacionat amb un aroma, perquè tots tenim a la memòria l'aroma de la terra molla.
And it was a very interesting process because we brought an element into the kitchen that it's usually not associated with the kitchen, because we all have in it the aroma of moist of wet soil in our memory.
Ens va donar joc, molt de joc. Vam fer inicialment unes ostres només amb destil·lat de terra.
At the beginning, it gave us lots of room to play, and at the very beginning, what we did is we did some oysters with only a soil distillation.
Era un mar i muntanya molt radical.
It was like a surf and turf, a very radical surf and turf.
Però que és un element molt important a la cuina catalana, és a dir, l'utilització d'elements del mar i de la terra junts amb un plat. Això era una síntesi fantàstica, molt radical, molt minimalista, però molt interessant a la dona.
But it was a very minimal and synthesis, but it was a very interesting one because it's a very good play in the way that the traditional Catalan cuisine works, between surf and turf.
Okay, anem a veure el plat de les ostres al Chablis.
Let's take a look at the oysters done with Chablis.
El Chablis és uns vins que es fan en una zona de la Borgonya, amb raïm chardonnay, molt particulars. Quan són vells desenvolupen un ventall d'aromes molt divers, molt interessant.
And el Chablis, as you know, it's a wine made in Bourgogne, and it's done with chardonnay grapes. And as it grows old, the vines and the grapes, they acquire a very interesting particular flavor.
Mel de càssia.
Acacia honey.
Poma verda.
Green apples.
Tòfona.
Truffle.
Champignons.
Mushrooms.
Terra.
Soil.
El que heu vist ara és el procés de fer uns candis d'aiguardent de mel d'acàcia. Hem barrejat almívar i aiguardent, ho hem barrejat molt a poc, com heu vist, i ho hem posat en una placa amb maicena, unes gotes, que després d'un procés de cocció esdevenen caramels líquids per dins.
What we've done is we've mixed the honey, the acacia's honey, and the...
Aiguardent de mel d'acàcia i un almívar.
Yep, syrup and the eau de vie made with acacia flowers. And what we do is we mix it together.
I ho hem posat en unes gotetes sobre una placa de maicena.
And we put it on top of some cornstarch.
Ho hem secat i han quedat, el caramel ha anat cap a fora, ha quedat cruixent i sòlid, i a dins ha quedat l'aiguardent líquid.
And what has happened is that we have dried it, and the outside it's crispy and solid, and inside is the liquid.
Això és el destil·lat de terra. Estem fent el destil·lat de terra amb el destil·lador, amb el rotaval.
With the rotary evaporator, we're distilling soil now.
Hem tret aire, hem modificat la pressió atmosfèrica i aconseguim bullir a temperatura molt més baixa de la normal.
What we've done is modify the atmospheric temperature
and treure l'aire,
to get the air out of it, and what we do is we cook at a lower temperature than usual.
Utilitzem aquest sistema perquè d'aquesta manera els aromes són molt més nets que si ho fem amb les temperatures altes dels destil·ladors que no tenen buit.
And in that way, what we achieve is like a cleaner taste as well to it that other rotators do not achieve because they don't have the sous-vide part of it.
Okay. Procés de destil·lació és molt simple: evaporació, condensació, precipitació. Tenim una aigua que ha arrastrat els aromes volàtils de la terra molla.
It's a very simple process. It's evaporation, condensation. And condensation and gathering or precipitation.
I d'aquesta manera tenim un líquid que ha arrastrat tots els aromes volàtils a la terra.
And then we have a liquid at the end that brings all the volatile flavors of earth, soil.
Per aconseguir el sabor i no perdre'l amb l'escalfament, volem donar densitat en aquest líquid i ho fem amb xantana perquè així no l'hem d'escalfar per donar densitat.
What we don't want to heat this liquid, and to get a sense of density, of texture, what we do is we use some xantana gum.
I muntem el plat.
And then we plate it.
Tots els elements.
With all the elements.
El destil·lat de terra en el centre del plat, és transparent.
The soil distillation in the middle of the plate.
Serà un element que irem trobant sempre quan anem degustant, quan anem menjant.
And when we eat, we'll encounter that, we'll bump into it.
Està en el centre. I al voltant anem posant oli de tòfones.
And on the sides we use truffle oil.
Compota de poma.
Apple...
De poma verda.
Marmalade. And green apple.
Estem posant els elements que hem dit que ens recordava l'aroma del Chablis.
And we bring here forward the elements that remind us of the aroma of Chablis.
Champignon cru.
Raw mushroom.
L'ostra, que la tallarem per poder-la integrar bé amb tots els elements i que sempre anem trobant un trosset d'ostra, és a dir, és una manera de dispersar-la i poder-la integrar amb la resta d'elements.
So it gets integrated and mixed with the rest of the other elements.
Okay. Els candis de mel, d'aiguardent de mel d'acàcia.
And the candy is made with acacia eau de vie.
A la zona de Chablis hi ha pedres calcàries blanques perquè, a més, és una zona que hi havia hagut ostres, és a dir, hi ha fòssils d'ostre a les vinyes de Chablis. I és per això que hem establert aquesta relació amb el paisatge, també.
And another way to bring together the landscape of the Chablis area is as well to the oyster reminds us of that because there is lots of stone flavor into it and lots of oyster fossils in the region.
Per tant, aquelles pedres representen pedres del paisatge de Chablis.
In a way, what they represent is stones from the Chablis landscape.
Okay, una altra aplicació de la destil·lació. Volem captar l'aroma volàtil de l'eucaliptus.
Another application of the distillation process is to capture the volatile aroma of eucalyptus.
I alhora volem transmetre la sensació de fred, de frescor.
At the same time, we want to bring a sense of cool, coolness.
Això és, són caramels Halls d'eucaliptus.
Són caramels què?
Caramels Halls d'eucaliptus.
Those are Halls made with eucalyptus.
Trencats, trencats.
Broken.
No? Sé, sí. I ara, ara estem fent unes roses de gel amb una barreja de clara d'ou i sucre llustre.
And what we do here is we confection sugar and egg white, we make some roses.
Yeah. I els deshidratarem, 50 graus durant 12 hores.
And we dehydrate them at 50 degrees for 12 hours.
I hem posat una miqueta de caramel de Halls.
A little bit of Hall caramel from candy yeah. From the Halls.
Yeah. El destil·lat, és la, estem deixant fer el destil·lat, anem evaporant, és a dir, destil·lant, evaporant i recuperant.
The distillation is underway. We evaporate and recover.
I llavors aquesta aigua destil·lada d'eucaliptus el que fem és posar-la en un congelador a menys 5 graus, 5 graus sota zero.
And with this water of eucalyptus that we have distilled, what we do is we freeze it at -5 degrees Celsius.
Okay. Això és meló.
That's melon.
Que el posarem a congelar a menys 18 graus.
And it's going to freeze at -18 degrees Celsius.
I ara muntem el plat. Això és una mousse de chartres. Chartres és un licor d'herbes fresques.
And now we are plating it. So that's a chartres mousse. As you know, chartres is made with fresh herbs.
Cogombre. Petits cogombres.
Cucumber, baby cucumbers.
Okay. I herbes anisades. Estragó, fonoll.
And herbs that have like an anise flavor, like tarragon, fennel.
Salicòrnia. Salicòrnia és un arbust que creix a als aiguamolls, una mica salat.
Salicòrnia? Els aiguamolls?
Sí, aiguamolls, marismes.
And then an herb that grows in marshes, only in marshes.
Hem posat compota de bergamota.
We use bergamot marmalade.
L'estrella, que ja està seca, està cruixent.
The star that now is dry and crispy.
Amb una mica de amb trossets de caramel Halls.
With the bits of Halls there.
Tot és molt fresc, és efervescent de llimona.
And everything is very fresh and effervescent.
Tot és molt fresc. Aquest és el meló que està a menys 18 graus i aquesta és l'aigua a menys 5.
And that's the melon at -18 and the water at -5.
A taula servim el plat i el camarer deixa caure l'aigua sobre el meló que en contacte amb el meló fa que es congeli de cop i es produeix aquest efecte màgic que alhora també dona una sensació de frescor. No?
And what happens... What happens at the table, the waiter, the cans, the sí. Pours the water on top of the melon and that gives that another fresh sensation.
Okay, ara farem un petit parèntesis i us explicarem un postre divertit que l'estem fent l'hem fet durant aquest últim any. Però no ho tenia previst, no estava previst, però serà una manera de posar una miqueta d'humor i d'explicar-vos que la cuina també intentem que tingui un cert sentit de l'humor.
Now we're going to do a little parenthesis here and we're going to show you a dish that we created very recently and you know, because we want to have that sense of fun and that we want to have as well that sense of humor in the kitchen.
No té res a veure amb la precisió de temperatura, no té res a veure amb el tema d'avui.
It doesn't have anything to do with the temperature precision or anything that we are talking about today.
Es tracta d'explicar a través de la cuina i dels elements que tenim a l'abast com crear una emoció, en aquest cas l'emoció de l'alegria o de l'eufòria.
What we want to do is with all the elements that we have in the kitchen to create an emotion. In that case, the emotion of happiness, of euphoria.
Per nosaltres, l'eufòria és veure com Messi marca un gol.
For us, euphoria is to see Messi.
Okay.
For those that don't know who Messi is, he's a player, soccer player from Barcelona. How he scores.
Okay. Abans cal explicar que aquest postre és el final d'un menú molt rigorós, molt seriós, molt en què tot està molt pensat. I pretenem que al final d'aquest menú pugui servir aquest postre i somriure una miqueta i relaxar una miqueta tota la concentració de l'àpat, no? de la part prèvia de l'àpat.
Before I want to say that that dessert that we're going to talk about now is the end of the meal after having a very rigorous, very serious, very formal experience, and in a way it's like to bring a smile into your face.
Okay. La idea és reproduir un gol molt concret que va marcar Messi la temporada passada.
The idea is to reproduce a very particular goal that Messi scored last season.
Assistència de Xavi, més capreta per Messi, 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 immens Messi, encara 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 Messi, gol, 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 increïble, increïble, no m'ho puc imaginar, no m'ho podia imaginar, no ho he vist mai això, no ho he vist mai, increïble, quina jugada, increïble, quina jugada, Messi, 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 però més i més i més, però més, però molt més, però molt, 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 molt.
Okay. El postre.
So, let's talk about the dessert.
Una pilota, mitja pilota.
The ball, half ball.
Ja. Gespa.
There is grass.
Un recipient que encaixarà dins del bol, dins de la pilota.
A container that will fit inside of the ball.
I dins del bol hi ha elements que associem amb l'alegria i amb l'eufòria.
And inside we have elements that we associate with happiness and euphoria.
Cítrics.
Citrus.
Llimones, elements efervescents.
Effervescent elements.
Compota de menta.
Mint jelly.
Petacetes.
Zats.
Pa, pa, pa. Exploten en la boca.
That they explode in your mouth.
Yeah. Granizado de limón.
A lemon granita.
Flors de menta, flores de menta.
Flower, mint flowers.
Espuma de bergamota.
Bergamot foam.
Són cítrics i mentes, bàsicament.
Mainly there are citrus and mints.
Oli essencial de gespa acabada de tallar.
Essential oil made with freshly cut grass.
Perquè quan arribi el plat sentis l'olor de la gespa com si estiguessis al camp.
So when the dish arrives in front of you, you can feel like if you're in the stadium.
Okay. Amb la clara d'ou i el sucre hem fet la xarxa de la porteria.
And with egg whites and sugar we've done the net.
I ara col·loquem uns merengues que te'ls hauràs d'anar menjant abans d'acabar el postre.
And what we do now is we put some meringues on top that you have to eat before dessert. Vols que expliqui allò del merengue?
Després. I la pilota, que és un gelat de dulce de leche.
And the ball, which is dulce de leche ice cream.
Hola. A la taula hi ha un petit iPod.
Hi ha un petit, oh, yeah.
Un petit iPod que sent, mentre menges el postre, sents empullar el que va...
And the other element about the dish is that we bring a nano iPod to the table where you can hear the girl. Explico la merengue.
Sí, okay.
Another food note is that merengue in for Barcelona fans, it's very clear what it is, but probably it's not for you. Merengue as well, it's the name that we give to Real Madrid fans. So there is a double pleasure about eating them.
Okay. Seguim.
Okay. Let's continue.
Us presento el Salvador. Salvador Brugués és qui va fer el llibre de cuina al buit amb mi el 2003.
I want to introduce Salvador Brugués, this guy that wrote the Subit book with me in 2003.
I que treballa amb nosaltres i que bueno, m'acompanya en aquest viatge i que us explicarà d'una manera molt evident la diferència que hi ha amb les temperatures quan coem. Quan coem productes, qualsevol producte, la relació temperatura-temps és evidentment un factor que canvia el resultat final de la cocció. I a l'ou...
And what he's going to do is he's going to show in a very obvious way the relationship that we have between time and temperature in the cooking process.
Fes tu.
Salvador works with us and he's come with me for this trip.
Avui bàsicament és una té com màxima importància la relació temps-temperatura.
In the sous vide cooking, the most important thing is the relationship between temperature and time.
Quan expliquem el buit o fem cursos, a vegades tanquem els cuiners 3 dies al celler i estem parlant 3 dies de tants graus de temperatura, tant temps, i maregem molt la gent.
What we do is when we talk about sous vide cooking and temperature, we lock all our cooks in the cellar for 3 days and we really hammer the, you know, the idea of the relationship between both of them.
També passar 5 minuts a 50 graus, aquesta temperatura on podem posar la mà tranquil·lament per fer una cocció.
What we do is we go from cooking 30 hours at 63 to 4 minutes at 50, and then it's even we can submerge even our hand without getting burned.
Per demostrar la importància que té aquesta relació temps-temperatura, sempre fem una petita prova quan ous a diferents temps amb dues temperatures diferents només amb un grau de diferència.
What we do to demonstrate here, that the relationship between time and temperature is we cook eggs at different, you know, at for the same time at just with 2 degrees of temperature different.
Aquest exemple ens demostra que amb un sol grau de diferència el temps i la temperatura ens marquen diferències totalment a l'hora de coure un aliment o un altre.
And here we can see very clearly the difference that one degree in temperature can make between, you know, all the eggs.
Well, llavors, hem cuit ous a 62 i a 63 graus durant 10, 20, 30, 40, 50, 60 i 120 minuts.
So we cook eggs at 62 and 63, starting at 10, 20, 30, 40, 50, 60 minutes.
I veurem com reacciona sobretot el rovell a mesura que anem incrementant el temps.
And then we want to see, especially the egg yolk, how it reacts to the way that we've been increasing the time.
En les primeres temperatures no hi ha gaire diferència. El rovell sempre és líquid, no hi ha massa diferència.
In the first temperatures, in the lower temperatures, there is not a big difference between the egg yolks. They are very liquid, as you can see.
En segons temperatures veiem que, tot i que a 20 graus el rovell encara és molt líquid, també ho serà, però hi ha una mica més espès amb un sol grau.
And then you can see that with 20 degrees, that there is a bigger difference between the two of them. And the second one is a little bit thicker.
Si anem pujant, veurem que a 62 anem mantinguent líquid, mentre que a 63 comencem a agafar densitat.
What we can see is that as we increase, is that at 62 it's still liquid, and at 63 it starts to be, we gather some density.
A 64 encara és totalment líquid després de 40 minuts, mentre que pràcticament ja està quallat amb un sol grau de temperatura.
At 64, you can see that it's very liquid still, but with, if we increase just 1 degree, you can see that it's very, it's starting to get solid.
A 50, encara tenim liquidesa.
At 50, it's still liquid.
Mentre que pràcticament ja tenim un ou quallat amb textura de tocinet. No sé si es coneix aquí el tocinet.
Gelea. And if we increase that 1 degree, you can see that we have almost something that it's binded together and it has the texture of a flan.
Exacte. Amb una hora de temps de cocció d'un ou, amb temperatures que nosaltres podem considerar semi de seguretat, encara tenim una llema cremosa, molt untosa.
And with 1 hour of time now, and we have still a yolk that it's very runny.
Mentre que amb un grau més tenim un ou cuit.
Well, if we increase 1 degree, we have a cooked egg.
L'exemple extremat, aquí no hi arribem mai nosaltres, però l'exemple extremat seria que amb 2 hores de cocció tenim que 62 encara és untable.
With 2 hours of time, you know, it's an example that we never reach in our cooking, but you can see that 62, it's still spreadable.
Mentre que exactament amb un sol grau de temperatura, amb 2 hores, tenim un ou dur, amb un sol grau tenim una textura totalment diferent.
And you can see that the same 2 hours, with increasing by 1 degree, we have a completely different texture.
És una mica la demostració que aquesta relació temps-temperatura amb el buit encara és més precisa.
That's a way to demonstrate that this relationship between time and temperature is even more precise when you do sous-vide cooking.
En plato jo i t'ho expliques?
Bueno, ara el que farem és donar-vos a provar un salmó.
Now we're going to give you some salmon to taste.
Hem posat a coure a 50 graus salmó tallat a daus.
It's a diced salmon that we cook at 50 degrees.
I ha estat uns 7 minuts.
It's been there for 7 minutes.
Sí. I ara el traiem de la bossa i us el donarem a provar.
And we're going to take it out of the bag and we are going to give it to you to taste.
Hem posat a dins del recipient una miqueta de compota de poma, una Granny Smith.
There is inside of each container some Granny Smith, some green apple jelly.
Posarem un dau de poma.
A little dice of apple.
I una mica d'oli de vainilla.
And vanilla oil.
Que l'hem fet també aquí, l'hem tingut, hem obert la vaina de vainilla i hem submergit amb oli de girassol i l'hem tingut al buit en el termostat durant un parell d'hores a 50 graus.
And we keep it in, you know, with a thermostat of 50 degrees for 2 hours. What we've done is we split vanilla bean and we cook it with sunflower oil.
Okay. La condimentació és una excusa, és un plat antic que fèiem, salmó amb poma i oli de vainilla. El que provareu bàsicament és la textura del salmó cuit d'aquesta manera. Cuit només a 50 graus, una temperatura baixa, i veureu que la textura és molt interessant i és molt diferent a la textura que obtindríem amb un salmó cuit a la planxa, en què tenim una part important de producte ressecat, deshidratat, i que hem perdut, a part de nutrients, molt sabor i molta textura.
The elements on the dish are just only, you know, just an excuse. The thing that I want you to concentrate is on the texture of the salmon. That's a dish that we used to do before with green apples and salmon, but you'll see that if you were to cook the salmon, to grill it, it would be dry and it would have lost lots of nutrients and flavor. While cooking it sous vide, it retains its essence.
Sí. Mentre anem emplatant, si algú té alguna pregunta.
Well, we plate the salmon. If anyone has any questions.
You infuse it with what?
Lagavulin scotch. Uh-huh. And I wondered why you A, used that kind of scotch, and B, you used, you garnished it with salt. And I wondered what kind of salt.
Que quan es fica el xai, que has posat escocès, que és un tipus molt especial d'escocès que li agrada molt I pregunta per què, I també quan has posat sal, al final, que has posat un tipus molt, si has posat un tipus particular de sal.
No, la sal era sal maldo.
Molten salt, to answer the salt part.
Sí, I l'altre em preguntava el whisky.
And the scotch.
Del filet.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
És Lagavulin.
Yeah. Diu que li agrada molt, si hi havia una raó particular per utilitzar-ho.
Sí, perquè a mi també m'agrada molt.
The reason is that I like it as well.
I sobretot perquè té una nota fumada molt important.
It's like a smoky element.
I volem jugar amb un filet a la brasa, amb el record d'un filet a la brasa.
And we want to play with the idea of grill, a grill filet.
Sí, és una associació que establim amb les verdures. Normalment en el restaurant les servim, les fem a la brasa. Llavors, per això hi ha una gran relació entre el sabor del whisky Lagavulin I les verdures a la brasa.
It's a relationship that we have already established at the restaurant. We do the same thing with vegetables, and what we do is we grill them, you know, because we really seek that smoky flavor.
Good evening, chef. Thank you very much for everything. How did you come to, I guess, what you defined as the proper temperature on certain things, like the foie and the goose, terrine, or things like that? I mean, is that trial and error? And you just keep experimenting until you get the right result? Or do you, I don't know, I mean, how do you decide that this is how what you want people to taste? This is the texture that you want?
Com arribes a la temperatura perfecta per fer una cosa? Si és un error I proves de nou, fas experiment d'una manera empírica, o si que decideixes que això és el tipus de temperatura que t'agradaria servir?
És un procés empíric, sobretot. Però alhora també tenim la sort ara de tenir molts llibres, com el llibre de Harold McGeer, que ens ajuda molt a entendre els productes I els processos que es produeixen quan cuinem. Per tant, entre el nostre gust, hi ha un procés empíric. Quan nosaltres arribem a un punt que diguem aquest és el gust que a mi m'agrada, la textura que a mi m'agrada, aquesta és la bona. Però evidentment al final tot té també una explicació científica.
That what we do is we, you know, it's a very empirical process. So what we do is we try and trial and error and to see the flavor that we want to achieve and, you know, taking notes. And at the same time everything makes sense and it has like a scientific explanation as well, but we base ourselves very much in flavor. And then some books like Harold McGee's book helps us as well, finding the perfect point and gives us some sense to it.
What is your worst experiment ever? Cooking experiment.
Gràcies per aquí, no, però quin és el pitjor experiment que has tingut mai? El pitjor experiment que has tingut mai a la cuina?
Bueno, hi ha un experiment que encara no hem fet, que en Jordi està intentant carregar cartutxos amb espècies per matar un colomí. amb espècies.
that there is an experiment that we have not done yet, but my brother Jordi, what he's trying to do is he's going to infuse a bullet with spices to kill a pigeon. To infuse the pigeon.
El gol de Messi semblava una idea impossible.
If you thought that Messi's goal was an impossible idea.
I al final ha estat una... Sí, que els colomins poden patir.
Yeah, pigeons are doomed.
Hi, Chef, thank you for coming. My question is about the snowflakes that you made with the royal icing and the Hall's cough drops. I want to know, why do you put them in the dehydrator? What does that do for them?
De la seva pregunta és els flecs de neu que has posat, les roses aquestes que has construït, per què les has deshidratat?
Per aconseguir textura cruixent. És un merengue, és una mena de... En terminologia culinària és la glaça real. La glaça real és clara d'ou amb sucre llustre, és una tècnica molt antiga, ja es feia estar en els receptaris del segle XVIII, i es feia per la pastisseria, i nosaltres el que fem és aplicar aquella tècnica, però donant-li una forma i aconseguint una cocció molt més baixa per aconseguir que quedi blanc, que no quedi torrat, i que quedi molt, molt cruixent.
What we do, the idea is to achieve extreme crispiness. It's a very old technique. We got inspired by 18th century cookbooks. They describe the technique. It's called a royal glaze, glacé. And that's why we dehydrate it, you know, to achieve an incredible crispiness in your mouth.
Hola, chef. En español y después en inglés. ¿La cocina china o japonesa lo ha influenciado en su manera de, en su técnica?
Sí. Al final, los cocineros cocinamos tenemos inspiración a partir de diferentes inputs, ¿no? Nuestros viajes, nuestras vivencias, de alguna manera están presentes en el proceso creativo. Mi viaje, sobre todo a Japón, fue muy, muy interesante para
bueno. The question was if Chinese or Japanese cooking has had any influence in you, and the answer is yes. You know, obviously, cooks were based in input and travels, and my trips to Japan have very much influenced me.
Sobre todo en las cocciones. Nosotros estábamos buscando cocciones muy ajustadas que alguien podría decir que está crudo, ¿no? Porque hay gente acostumbrada a comer el pescado, por ejemplo, muy, muy, muy cocido. Entonces, ver cómo en Japón lo toman crudo te da, de alguna manera, una otra visión de cómo tratar un producto y que tú puedes jugar entre... el abanico se abre mucho más entre muy cocido y crudo. Buscas el punto ideal para ti. ¿No?
Especially in when we talk about temperature, obviously Japanese cuisine was an inspiration because we eat like Japanese food. It's raw, and then you have to go from there and get the level that you feel that it's, you know, that it's very good for cooking fish, and that it's, you know, and that becomes your inspiration. It's a parting point.
Question here: when you're cooking fish, it seems you're using a higher temperature of the water for a lower temperature core of the fish, meaning I use a 50-degree water for let's say a 40-degree core for the fish. There are two questions. First, does he ever use the same temperature of water for the same temperature he wants to achieve for the fish? The other question is, if it's a thicker piece of fish and the temperature of the water is higher, how does that affect the outside of the fish until the core of the fish reaches 40 degrees?
La seva,
It's a long question. I could break it down.
Yeah, please, please.
Okay. He uses a higher temperature for the bath. The temperature of the bath for fish, I notice, is higher, meaning 50 degrees Celsius for, let's say, a 40-degree core temperature of the fish.
Que la temperatura que utilitzes pel peix, que heu notat que és una mica més alta, de 40 graus, que és molt més alta perquè utilitzes.
50 graus.
Yeah, perquè és més alta d'això, ja. 50 degrees, isn't it?
Yes, sometimes the core of the fish is not 50, it's lower than that, he achieves.
Que moltes vegades el centre del peix és menys que 50, llavors que és com ho logres, no?
En una de les imatges abans hem vist com clavàvem una sonda, una sonda molt prima d'un termòmetre que ens permet tenir la temperatura a cor de producte. Aquest... Ah, està aquí.
So, that's the best way to demonstrate that.
Aquesta,
the thermometer with
aquesta espuma
with a meat thermometer.
La podem clavar, la podem enganxar sobre la bossa de buit, clavar la sonda, uh-huh. arribar fins al cor del producte uh-huh. i saber a quina temperatura està el cor.
What we do is we use a very special technique. We put the foam on top of the bag, and then with the thermometer we go down, and then we see the temperature of the core.
Això ho fem una vegada quan busquem la taula, quan decidim que aquesta és la textura ideal, busquem quina és la temperatura que dona i per tant sabem quina temperatura ha de tenir l'aigua i quant temps hi ha d'estar.
So what that we do that once at the very beginning when we're establishing the table to see exactly what we want to achieve and what's exactly the temperature of the water to achieve that. But we just do that once at the beginning.
Clar, no ho fem cada vegada, sinó que ho fem un cop per precisar quina és la taula ideal per a aquell producte, segons el nostre criteri.
So we do that, obviously we don't do that every time that we plate the dish, but we just do that at the beginning to establish some parameters, to establish a table so that can guide us. And obviously it has to do with our taste for that, you know, how we want it to taste.
The question is, would he use 40 degrees water to cook fish to 40 degrees? That's really the question.
La pregunta és que si són de 40, que si utilitzaries 40 graus de l'aigua per 40 graus de la temperatura de dintre del peix.
Sí, però necessitaria molt més temps.
But I would need more time.
Més temps.
Good evening, chef. I'm just wondering... Being in the restaurant industry, I know there's a sense of urgency to get the food out quickly so that there is hot food at the table. Do you still feel the sense of urgency to get the food out with speed and efficiency, or is it okay to go out on a plate lukewarm? And I'm also amazed with your experiment. I think the correlation between time and temperature is unbelievable.
Que sent una persona que treballa a restaurants que vol saber si realment sents la pressió de posar els plats a fora ràpids i de treure'ls de la sala ràpidament o si penses que, bé, que la temperatura, el resta de coses que fas, el teu art...
Treballem amb temperatures molt baixes, per tant és molt important l'organització interna en la cuina.
So since we work with very low temperatures, the internal organization of our kitchen is very important.
Som 35 cuiners.
35 cooks in our kitchen.
I cuinem per 45 clients.
And we cook for 45 people.
Llavors, estem molt a sobre del producte, del procés, de l'acabat, de l'emplatat, i busquem una certa agilitat per no perdre la temperatura.
So what we do is we have that process very much by hand, and we have some agility as well, but obviously to respect the rules of the temperature that we try to achieve.
Oh, hi. So my question is regarding creativity, in the sense that first off, my question is, who is responsible for creativity in the restaurant? Is it the sense of, I understand you and your brothers are overlooking the whole concept, but do you utilize all of your cooks? Do all of your cooks sit down and discuss different recipes? And my second question is, can you very briefly, I guess, describe your process of creativity in the sense of capturing an essence, capturing an emotion, such as like the soccer goal, capturing pleasure, you know, in a dish. How does that come to fruition for you and your team?
El que dos preguntes del procés creatiu que deu pensar que està a les mans teves i dels teus germans també, però quin paper tenen els cuiners en aquest procés creatiu, si tenen una decisió o no? I segona, per exemple, com és el teu procés creatiu? En què et bases? Perquè hem entès, per exemple, l'exemple de la pilota de Messi, tot això del gol de Messi, però volíem saber quina és la inspiració, si hi ha
uns paràmetres. És una pregunta complicada. Estaríem hores explicant el procés creatiu perquè és complex.
It's a very complex question and a very complex process, so we would spend many hours describing it.
Però hi ha uns inputs importants, no? La memòria, les vivències.
There are some very important inputs. One of them is memory.
La tradició de la cuina catalana és molt important.
The tradition of the Catalan cuisine is very important as well.
La cuina acadèmica, la cuina, diguem-ne, que tant en Badó com jo som professors a l'Escola d'Hostaleria de Girona, i aquest contacte amb els alumnes i les tècniques tradicionals, o diguem-ne, que en diguem acadèmiques de tota la vida, també són importants en el procés creatiu per agafar punts de partida.
And to have some departure points as well, both Salvador and myself, we teach cooking in Girona, and we base ourselves in what we can call academic cooking, you know, as a departure point as well.
El món del vi també és un input important, és a dir, els aromes del vi ens poden donar una pista. La busca de contrastos, la busca d'emocions.
The contrast and emotions that, you know, that we seek as well.
I els cuiners que estan a la cuina també participen. Demanem sovint que ens presentin idees. Els hi demanem que cada setmana ens presentin una idea nova, un plat nou, i llavors els avaluem nosaltres.
And another thing, you know, to answer your question, we ask our cooks as well to participate in the creative process, and we ask them every week to come up with a dish or an idea so we can evaluate ourselves.
Okay, so I think there's still a plate going back. If you didn't get any of the salmon, you can try it at the back. Also, there's book signing outside, and you can buy the course aprons with the equations on the outside. And let's thank Joanne one more time.